I'm Rod Serling.
You unlock this door with the key of imagination. Beyond it is another dimension. A dimension of sound, a dimension of sight, a dimension of mind. You're moving into a land of both shadow and substance, of things and ideas. You've just crossed over into the Twilight Zone.
Here is your room, gentlemen.
Thank you.
I'll turn on the lamp.
Leave it off for now.
As you wish. I am sorry it's so small, sir.
It suits our purposes.
Where is the bath?
Down the hall.
The hall?
I can give you one with a private bath, if you prefer.
No, no. I said this will do.
I'm afraid the dining room is closed at this hour, but you may take a meal at the cafe down the street.
We're not hungry, my friend and I.
Then I bid you good evening.
Good night. Check the window, Boris.
You chose the right room.
Of course.
There is Kuchenko, in his room, across the alley.
Binoculars?
Right here, Commissar.
Yes. Yes. See? The Major lies on his bed, but he does not sleep.
He will sleep very soon. Give me one shot with this rifle.
Not yet, Boris. That would be too easy.
Easy? A clean kill.
I have something more challenging in mind.
Something
along the lines of a game, perhaps.
I don't like games.
Not even a game of cat and mouse?
What for?
To make him squirm a bit before the hammer falls?
We waste time, Commissar.
Patience, my friend. Hand me the phone.
Who are you calling?
Hickory Dickory Dock.
Front desk.
Yes. Excuse me, but do you have a Mr. Kuchenko in your hotel?
One moment. Sorry, no one by that name.
Ah, but I happen to know that my friend is staying there. Perhaps he is registered under another name? Andreev?
I'll check. Yes, Mr. Andreev, room 963.
Very good. Will you connect me, please?
Yes, sir.
Look, he hears it.
Of course he does.
He rises from the bed to answer.
Yes?
This is Major Kuchenko. Hello, Major? Are you there, Major?
The cast of characters in our drama? A cat, a cat's assistant, and a mouse. This is the latter, the intended victim, who does not know but may have already guessed that he is to die. His name is Major Ivan Kuchenko, and he was lately an officer in the former Soviet Union. At this point, he has, if events go according to certain predetermined plans, perhaps 3 or 4 more hours of living. But an ignorance shared by both Major Kuchenko and his executioner is the fact that both have taken rooms at adjacent hotels in a section of the city located beyond the checkpoints of the Twilight Zone.
And now, the Twilight Zone and our story, The Jeopardy Room, with Stacy Keach as your narrator.
This is Major Kuchenko.
Who is calling?
Major Kuchenko, you don't know me.
Who is this?
But I have heard of your recent arrival here.
You have the wrong number.
And I wanted you to know that you have friends in this city.
Friends, you say? And they would be...
Good friends, Major. Staunch friends.
I know no one in this city.
May I impose upon you to remain in your room for a little bit? Your friends will make themselves known.
And who is this speaking? Is this a friend also?
A good friend, Major. Not known to you yet, perhaps, but soon to become acquainted.
And why must I...
stay in my room?
We'll be making contact with you very shortly.
For what purpose?
Your welfare. Your well-being is our deepest concern, Major.
Now, Commissar.
Not yet, Boris. May I count on you to show some sense, Major? For your own safety, I urge you to remain in your room. You'll be seeing your friends before long. The mouse is in the trap.
He stands at the window. Now, Commissar?
Patience.
But I have him in the crosshairs. I could make his head leave his shoulders at this range.
That would give you pleasure, wouldn't it?
A great deal of pleasure, Commissar. Just say the word. Even when he lies down, I can still see his head.
I believe it, Boris. I know of your prowess, but put the gun away.
Put it away?
Lay it aside. For a bit.
We're not going to kill him?
Ah, the eagerness of the young. They do not sip wine. They gulp it down like a soft drink. They do not fondle women. They devour them. They do not sniff at the essence of a perfume. They try to jam it into their nostrils. But now, consider the window across the way. The gentleman will die without question. But I want him to die, Boris, with finesse, with subtlety, with a degree of thought and care.
A killing is a killing. And if a man is to die, what does it matter how he dies?
Ever been to a bullfight, Boris?
A bullfight? No, Commissar, I've never had that pleasure.
A bullfight might serve to make the distinction. In such a contest, if the matador kills with grace, that is considered a good death.
So, there are good deaths and bad deaths, are there?
Precisely. There is death with art, and there is the death of the butcher. You, Boris, are a butcher. Now, that is an honorable profession of great usefulness, but I'm an artist. Oh, you will have a death tonight, within a few hours. But when it is over, we will have killed with artistry, Boris. Not with a meat cleaver or an explosive bullet or any other of the butcher's tools. This death will be like a ballet.
Yes?
Major Kuchenko?
Who is it?
A friend, Major. If you prefer, you can turn off the lights and find a hiding place. I'll come in with my hands up, palms open. Major Kuchenko?
And you are?
I am a friend. May I?
For a moment.
I would prefer that you put the gun away.
Not a chance. Were you the one on the telephone?
We had a brief chat earlier. Quite a place you have here. Who occupied it before you? A rat?
I have no luxury of choices.
Indeed not. In this respect, you are a very poor man of late. However, you have a bed. You have some pictures on the wall. And a floor without so much as a throw rug. An adequate accommodation. And a view of a brick building alongside. I suppose there are worse places to spend an evening, Major?
I know. I've been to many of them.
Indeed. Indeed you have. Siberia is cold this time of year, is it not, Major? I'm told it's a most uncomfortable climate.
You've been told quite correctly. It's a freezing jungle.
A freezing jungle. Marvelous. Lovely imagery. Siberia is a freezing jungle.
It was. When it was part of the Union.
You make reference, of course, to the people who inhabited it.
I make reference to some people. Those who were in charge of that private resort.
It must have been unpleasant for you? At least sufficiently unpleasant to motivate you to renounce your native land and try to seek asylum elsewhere?
For a time. Asylum is no longer necessary under the new regime.
Ah, but of course the old ways die hard. Some of the same people remain in charge. and they might be concerned about their public perception in this new world. To the victors go the spoils, and that includes access to certain, let us say, sensitive information?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Really? But I think you do. You were a political prisoner. You served a term of 12 years. You escaped and you moved quickly when the borders were opened. To bring us up to date, you have made your way to a neutral country, somehow avoiding an official debriefing. You have made contact with certain foreign agencies, and now you're desperately trying to get on an airplane that will take you to a Western nation. But for some reason, you feel that you're still under surveillance?
Oh, it's more than a feeling. I know I'm under surveillance.
Do you know by whom?
I know very well.
Can you tell me who they are?
Look in the mirror. Commissar Vasilov?
Very discerning, Major. You remember faces?
I remember pain. I remember some interrogations that went on for many weeks. I had no calendar, but I made marks on the wall of my cell.
How resourceful.
I remember one particular man who smoked Balkan cigarettes in a long holder and stood in the corner of the room, smiling and nodding, making jokes, while I went from agony to agony.
So, Major, now we may dispense with the amenities. The masquerade, the little give and take of two strangers feeling each other out.
Agreed.
Now we get to the point. Do you honestly think that we would permit you to book passage on an aircraft out of here? That would be quite impossible. As a former member of the military, even as far back as 12 years ago, you have information that we would find embarrassing were it to be released elsewhere.
Why, if the government we worked for no longer exists?
Because the new government contains many of the same players reshuffled into different positions, and they have their new careers to consider. Consequently, Major, it is not to our advantage that you leave. It would, of course, be simpler and more convenient if you accompany me back to our embassy.
I am sick, tired, and torn, Vasilov. But I am not insane. I would sooner cut my wrists over a sink and bleed to death. That would be my choice in the matter.
You surely can't be serious, Major. I'm rather a connoisseur of the several hundred ways for a man to depart the earth. And you can believe me when I tell you, the cutting of the wrist is not a particularly felicitous modus operandi. Quite apart from the pain, which, of course, must be attendant, is the fact that one dies slowly, and because of this, he has to be an eyewitness to his own demise. No, my dear friend, I'm afraid we are of two minds about that kind of death. But enough. I have brought you a small gift. Consider it a peace offering.
Careful!
Gently, Major. Gently. This happens to be a bottle of Amontillado. Quite rare and most pleasing to the palate.
I have to repeat what I told you before, Commissar. I'm not insane. I'm quite aware of what would happen to me if I drank any of that.
Why, Major? I'm disappointed in you. With your kind indulgence, allow me to use your own water glasses. If you assume this is to be cyanide or some other poison, you're quite wrong.
Am I?
Undoubtedly. You see, I don't share your death wish. I'm a healthy man with excellent expectations as to my longevity. No, indeed, Major. I was about to propose a social drink. The two of us. I'll drink first, and then you. Satisfactory?
Such ritual, Commissar. Such tribal rites. Yet you have only one purpose with me. Why don't you get it over with? If you're trying to disarm me and make me get rid of this pistol, it'll take more than a social wine.
Indeed, Major. Now, as to my business with you, we both know what that is.
Go ahead and say it.
Very well. I'm to see that you're dead by tomorrow morning. Is that plain enough?
Quite plain.
And you shall be, Major. With a degree of immodesty, I can say that I've killed 800 times you. But I've done it, Major, with subtlety, with originality, with ingenuity. I'm the last of the imaginative assassins, an artist of the profession, as it were. Excellent. Flavor. Bouquet. Just the proper dryness. Really, quite an exceptional wine. Join me, Major?
And now?
And now I will tell you something else. I will tell you something about you and me.
Please.
You, Major, are a malcontent. A genuine curiosity. A rebel with no cause to speak of. You have to go to prison camps, to interrogation centers, or hide in filthy little rooms. You can never accept that which is ordained.
And you?
I, on the other hand, am a survivor. I adapt to my situation. I haven't a large salary, and my job, at least the way it's laid out, is a rather dull one. Finding defectors and traitors and subversives and doing away with them. Now, I could do that with a high-powered rifle. I could do it with a homemade bomb. But I choose to exercise imagination and taste. In your case...
In my case?
In your case, I choose to prolong the game. And in the process of this prolongation, I've come up with what I think is a most bizarre and novel method of execution. One designed especially to challenge your talents. For we are worthy adversaries, you and I.
I feel weak. I feel...
Tell me what you feel, Major. Exactly. I want to know.
Why, you... You monster. You drugged me after all.
Indeed I have. And that poses an interesting question, doesn't it? How is it that we both can drink of the same wine, and yet I'm unaffected? Isn't that an interesting question, Major? Major?
My head. He's gone. But I'm still alive. So he wants to play a game. And he has left something behind. What is this?
Greetings, Major Kuchenko. I'm an exceptionally good judge of men.
Are you?
And in my judgment of you, I made an assumption that you are sufficiently observant to see the tape recorder on top of your dresser and curious enough to play it. How could you resist? This will also suggest to what complicated ends I'm willing to go to make a simple execution different and imaginative. First of all, to clear up one point. You may remember our discussion. Before I left you, I proposed a question. Isn't it odd that we both drank of the same wine, and how different the effect? Isn't it odd? Really, quite incredible and bizarre. How can it be? In all honesty, Major, how do you explain it?
Go ahead. I'm listening, you...
Perhaps you have figured it out already. The truth is, I have been imbibing this particular drug for many years, a sort of experiment with myself as the subject. I have now reached the point where my physical tolerance has risen so that I can drink it by the gallon and remain quite unaffected. This in itself is a rather common and uninspired trick, a phenomenon well known to the scientific community. But you will also note, and I hope with a degree of pleasure, that you have not been poisoned. You're very much alive.
Where are you?
As you've probably perceived, I'm rather a gamesman when it comes to killing. I adhere to my own rules and ethics. Hence, Major Kuchenko, I have taken the liberty of removing your pistol so that you won't hurt yourself. Now listen to the following quite carefully. This is the game, and these are the rules. You have been asleep for roughly 3 hours. During that time, in addition to dictating this on the recorder, I have done the following. I have placed a booby trap in your room. It is not visible, but it is attached to a very common object that is in the room. If you trigger this object, it will detonate and you will immediately be blown up.
Why not get it over with now, sadist?
Now, for a proposition. If during the next 3 hours you are able to find this booby trap and cut the wire, you will be permitted to leave the room alive and unharmed. This is a guarantee. You have my word on it.
Your word?
But the following conditions are of the essence, Major. You must actively search for this booby trap, and you must find it and render it inactive. It goes without saying that, as of this moment, you are being observed.
How?
Attempt to turn out the lights, and you will be shot. The moment you stop an active search, should you refuse to play the game, you will also be shot. If you are unable to find the trap within 3 hours, or attempt to leave the room at any point during that time, I am afraid the same conditions apply. You will receive a bullet in the head. So there you have it, Major. Find the booby trap, cut its wires, and you're free. Fail to find it, or fail to look for it, you're dead. Look for it, find it, but fail to recognize it, you're also dead. Needless to say, Major Kuchenko, it is this latter occurrence that I rather expect and look forward to. As a fellow expert in tricks and deception, I think you will admit this situation has its own special imaginative quality.
Where are you?
Where are you?
Over here, Major. Just across the way. So near and yet so far. Can't you see me? Doesn't the light reflect in my binoculars? Look, Major. Please look. Try, I implore you. Where have you been, Boris?
I brought food from the cafe.
Food is of no consequence. Quickly, he's awake.
Don't worry, Commissar. I have a clear shot anywhere in the room.
Hold your fire until I tell you.
But why? Such an easy target.
Too easy. That is the difference between us, Boris. You are a marksman, but I am a gamesman. And the game is afoot.
The picture frame? No, no. Too obvious. The ceiling. The light fixture. Possibility. Nothing. Oh, you think you are so clever, Commissar. So clever. The bed, then. Under the mattress.
The bed springs?
It might be.
Not the chair, though.
Still possible.
Where?
Ah, that would be telling. Go ahead and eat Boris before it gets cold. He's busy with the hunt for now. What did you bring?
Sandwiches. Have one, Commissar.
I never eat while I'm working. I'm like an athlete, Boris. Food is a distraction.
Food is good.
It makes one sluggish, affects the concentration. The morning will come soon enough. Over here, Kuchenko, just across the alley. Don't you see?
He sees nothing.
But surely a fragment of light, a stray reflection. Perhaps he has seen us. Yes, yes, he must know. But he refuses to acknowledge. He is too proud. He knows he must do this on his own and will not give me the satisfaction.
The bookshelf? Or the books themselves? Which one? An atlas? A novel? The Bible, of course. It's already been moved an inch, 2 inches. But the wire? Where? One way to find out. The bookcase itself, then. Behind the books. In the wood, the nails. Or under the floorboards. Wait, think. Where would I put it? You want a real battle of wits, Vasilov? You've got it. Think. Four walls. Ceiling. Light fixture. Floor. A picture. Bed with frame. Box springs, mattress, headboard, a night table, bookshelf, dresser, window, desk. First the drawers, the top one. Slowly, slowly.
What is he doing now?
The desk. He's down on his hands and knees removing the two bottom drawers so he can see what's under the top one. Bravo, Major. Good thinking.
Is that where you put it?
The possibility exists. Look at him, glistening like a mackerel. He stops to wipe the sweat from his eyes.
And?
And now he looks under the top drawer, crawling on his back.
Yes.
I think he's got it.
Let me kill him.
Don't be a fool. There are rules. Now he sees a length of wire. He grasps it between his fingertips very, very carefully, and he has removed it.
Something is wrong with the bomb?
I doubt it.
Then it was not in the drawer?
Oh, there is a piece of coat hanger I placed there. A decoy. A drawer would be common, uninspired. And I'm not, you'll forgive the modesty, a common executioner.
Where is it, Commissar?
In a most ingenious place. Really, quite an ingenious place.
Not in the books, the desk, the mattress.
Think of another common object in that room, Boris.
I have it.
Yes?
The doorknob.
Interesting idea.
Then where?
I'd rather not tell you at the moment, Boris. I think you'll enjoy the next few minutes more if you share the Major's ignorance.
You seem very sure.
Sure?
That he'll find the trap. You take a risk.
Not at all. That's not what I'm sure of. That is to say, I'm reasonably sure he'll find it, given his mental capacity. But he'll find it too late.
He's looking toward us.
But he can't see us. It's quite dark in here. And it wouldn't matter if he did see us.
Now he's returning to the table.
You're getting warm, my young friend.
The ashtray.
Extremely warm, but not hot.
Where then? Please, Commissar, please tell me.
Take the glasses. What do you see?
He stands over the telephone. He is reaching out.
Hot now, Boris. Extremely hot.
Oh, he has picked it up. I thought for a minute there...
You thought what?
The telephone.
Precisely. The telephone.
But he just lifted the receiver.
Indeed. He lifted the receiver to call out. If, on the other hand, the Major's telephone were to ring and he were to answer it...
That's it, isn't it? If he picks up the phone after it rings...
You have it now, my friend. When the Major's phone rings and he answers it, I have placed a tiny bottle of nitroglycerin inside the mechanism. The explosion will only occur after the ring and the lifting of the receiver, at which point the electrical contact will be made, and Major Kuchenko will not even have time to say hello.
But what if no one calls?
Oh, someone will. I promise you, someone will.
Front desk.
This is the party in 963. I was wondering...
Yes, sir?
I was wondering if you might have the number of another hotel.
Another hotel?
The one next door, across the alley.
That would be the Grand. You can find it in the directory, in the table by your bed. Dial 9 first, then the number.
I see. Thank you. Vasilov? I know you're there, Vasilov. The game is not over yet!
Do you have the time, Boris?
What?
The time.
5:10. Almost done, Commissar.
He's tried almost everything. He has 10 more minutes.
Hadn't I best go over there now and finish it?
No, my young friend. That would be impetuous. It would also be a bit embarrassing if someone were to see you.
At this hour? The streets are empty.
Quite apart from the fact that I wanted this to be imaginative, I also wanted subtlety. I should like our quarry to die in his room without our being there.
Opportunity is running out.
Then I do believe that it's time to, shall we say, accelerate the process? Hotel Mont Blanc? Would you dial room 963, please? Thank you. I'll wait.
There it goes. He's walking toward it.
What's the fool doing? Why doesn't he answer it?
I can't tell. He has his back to the window.
Turn around so I can see.
Now, Commissar?
No, no. Would you dial 963 one more time, please? Yes, I know it didn't answer. Ring it again. What's he doing, Boris?
His back is still to me.
It can't be busy.
I don't know.
What's he doing? Use the glasses.
He's turning around, lighting a cigarette.
He's mocking me.
Now, he suddenly dropped from sight.
Kill him.
I can only see the top of his head. He's moving across the room.
Do it! You missed, you fool.
He's at the door.
Again.
He's gone out of the room.
And you missed him. You missed, you idiot.
Flight 17 to Rome, Paris, and New York. Now pre-boarding.
Ticket, sir.
Ticket? Oh, yes.
Mr. Andreev. Passport?
Right here.
I see.
Is anything wrong?
No, sir. Everything seems to be in order. How many bags?
No luggage.
Not even a carry-on?
I'm traveling light.
Then here's your seat assignment. Please go to gate 17.
How much time do I have?
Boarding for coach class begins in 5 minutes.
Good.
Sir?
I mean, thank you. I'll be there.
What a mess he left behind.
Like a pigsty.
He tore the bed apart and the furniture. Oh, just look. Oh, even my poor little tape recorder.
Commissar?
Yes, Boris?
It would have been better, wouldn't it?
What would?
If I had taken his head off in the first place.
You mean if we had slaughtered him like an animal? I love your style, Boris. You should have been a pig farmer.
Our man would have been dead by now.
He would have been dead if we had beaten him to death with mallets, too. But anyone can die that way. And any stupid, insensitive fool can kill that way. No, this is a man of quality, with a resourceful mind, similar, you might say, to his executioner. He deserves a better ending, as do I. But that's all right. I have time. I'll get him in the next city, now that I know my adversary.
We will be able to track him?
Most certainly. The old network still functions, though in a much different way. I have the same contacts, no matter what they now call themselves. Importers, exporters, businessmen of various stripes, here and abroad. It's marvelous, you know. Really marvelous. Think of the possibilities. Other, even more ingenious methods of doing away with Kuchenko and his kind.
I still think we should have chased him.
Not at all. He would have gotten away. And even if he hadn't, it would mean that a thick-headed clod like you is more efficient than I. And this I reject, Boris. This I reject in toto.
Look at this. A bottle of wine. I can only find one glass.
Throw it away.
One drink, Commissar.
I said no.
But there is more than half left.
This is not for you.
But why?
Do you know much about Amontillado?
I know about vodka.
Of course, you and all the other potato growers. Give me the glass.
Here.
Believe me, it wouldn't agree with you. It's an acquired taste.
Yes, Commissar. If you say so.
I say so. There are some secrets that you're not ready to learn. But in time, Boris. In time. For now, I need you awake and alert.
That's right. I do what you say, as always. But so far, your methods are not very effective. The men who pay us, they will not be impressed.
And you will make a report? Only I can do that. I am the one they listen to.
I can request another assignment.
You're free to do so.
Until then, I take no further orders from you.
As you wish. You might want to reconsider, though. The resort in Siberia may be closed, but there are others. We have allies. All it would take is a single phone call. Comrade Boris, uncooperative, recalcitrant, unwilling to follow instructions. In this new order, there are not many positions for the uneducated, the blockheads with families. Yes?
Well,
you want to say something?
I withdraw my complaint.
What's that? I didn't hear you.
I am tired, Commissar. I say many things when I am tired.
You wish to apologize?
Yes.
Very well. I will take it under advisement. In the meanwhile, see if Major Kuchenko left anything behind. Check the closet, the drawers.
Yes, Commissar.
And life goes on. The sun comes up and we arise to meet another day. Prevail by our wits, and our wits alone.
I'll get it, Commissar.
No, Boris!
I don't play fool, no!
I'm sorry, sir. Your party doesn't answer.
No?
It doesn't ring at all now.
You're sure? Mont Blanc Hotel, room 963.
Strange. The line is suddenly dead.
Thank you, operator. That means my message got through.
Flight 17, Transocean Airways, now departing from New York City via Belgrade, Paris, Rome, London, and Nightfall.
Major Ivan Kuchenko, on his way west, on his way to freedom. A freedom bought and paid for by a most stunning ingenuity. Exit a gunman named Boris and one Commissar Vasilov, who forgot that there are two sides to an argument and two parties on every line. This has been a collect call, placed direct to you from a phone booth located somewhere in the Twilight Zone.
The Jeopardy Room with Stacy Keach as your narrator was adapted for radio by Dennis Etchison and written for The Twilight Zone by Rod Serling. Heard in the cast were Yasin Pelyankov, Jamie Van, Terry Berner, Katrina Lenk, Ned Noyes, Anna Sveruzza, and Lisa Dotson. To learn more about the Twilight Zone radio dramas and to obtain audio cassettes and CDs of these programs, visit our website at twilightzoneradio.com. The producers of the Twilight Zone wish to thank CBS Enterprises, Carol Serling, Dennis Etchison, Dick Brescia Associates, Claire Simon Casting, Terry Jennings, XM Satellite Radio, Sirius Satellite Radio, our sponsors, and our radio affiliates for helping make this series possible. Doug James speaking.